All right, joining us this morning on Hot Copy to start off the week, we have Senator Risa Ontiveros. Senator Risa, good morning to you.
Good morning, Karen.
All right, let's start our discussion off with increased military presence in the Philippines following the visit of U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris. Do you share the same fears as that former military official on more sites being built in the Philippines through EDCA? What are your thoughts?
Well, as someone who went through the movement in the late 80s and early 90s, for the Senate eventually to vote no to the renewal of the RPUS basis agreement, Karen, syempre, mapapaisip din ako dito sa manifestation ngayon ng Enhanced Defense Cooperation Agreement or EDCA. I was glad as a woman na bumisita si US Vice President Kamala Harris, isang kapwa leader kababaihan, and I appreciate the expressions of support from any nation, USA man yon o iba pa, upholding our victory at the Hague, no? Yung ruling ng tribunal na yon para sa Pilipinas at laban sa China, especially regarding the tensions, particularly in the West Philippine Sea, bukod pa sa buong South China Sea. Kaya bukas ako sa ganyang mga joint military exercises sa karagatan, especially as they show support for our country, for the Philippine Navy, for the Coast Guard, pati para sa BFAR. Pero medyo ibang usapin yung magtatayo ng sites sila on our land. At yun yung limang ibinalitan nyo na nga kanina, Karen. Iba pa po yun. And it also recalls what the President recently said, though in relation to China in particular, in our mind, na hindi nila sisuko ni isang pulgada ng teritoryo ng Pilipinas. So, and I share these thoughts with you, Karen, in the context of my dream of an independent and interdependent foreign policy, especially with ASEAN or like-minded countries in the ASEAN, and then regional and global formations like the Quad, na lahat with mutual respect for the Philippines will help us in resolving the tensions and preventing open conflict sa ating karagatan. Ayokong maipit tayo sa pagpili sa dating colonial master at sa bagong gustong maging regional or global, as it were, colonial master dito sa ating bansa.
All right. Now, following that visit, I know that the Makabayan Bloc also opposes what's called the 1-2-3 agreement between the Philippines and the United States. This provides the legal basis for U.S. exports of nuclear equipment and material to the Philippines. As we know, and the president is open to studying nuclear energy. Do you share the same stand as the Makabayan Bloc, or is Senator Risa Ontiveros open to nuclear energy?
Parang ang daming throwback tayong napag-uusapan ngayon, Karen. Naging aktivista ako first and foremost because of the peace issue. High school ako, teenager, nagbuo kami ng nuclear disarmament group sa Sainsco, Manila. So working against the then Bataan Nuclear Power Plant, the then nuclear-powered and the nuclear arms-bearing planes and ships na dumadaong at lumalapag sa nooy U.S. military and naval bases dito sa Pilipinas. At ngayon, lalo na umunlad na yung renewable energy, pati dito sa ating energy mix, I continue to believe that we have much better, safer, cheaper, and renewable energy sources compared to the prospects of opening a nuclear energy program here in the Philippines. Mapadaan man yan sa isang revived Bataan nuclear power plant or kahit yung mga sinasabi nilang what do they call them?
Modular.
Reactors. Exactly. Eh kahit sa mga di umanong modular na yan, Karen, sabi nila mas maliit. Sabi nila ngayon ang nuclear energy daw ay malinis, mas ligtas daw. But just recently, we had Fukushima. We had, before Three Mile Island, there was also Chernobyl. And until now, even those nuclear energy advocates cannot, as in hindi kayang, sagutin yung tanong na paano ligtas na isustore yung radioactive nuclear waste. My gosh, Karen, yung half-lives ng mga radioactive wastes na yan will outlive our generation, will outlive our children's generation. At kahit yung mga advocates ng nuclear energy, hindi pa nila ma-resolve yung issue niyan.
Okay. So is it fair to say that you are against nuclear power as a whole, considering that you do have Western countries that source most of their energy from nuclear? The U.S., for example, France being second, and it's the cheapest of a form of energy today.
It's the cheapest for them in dollars or euro terms. Pero pag kinenta natin, Karen, yung environmental and health hazards and other socio-economic aspects, more hidden aspects of nuclear energy, hindi siya value for money para sa kanila at lalo na para sa atin. And not to mention the fact that we have much better, even in peso terms, renewable energy alternatives. Solar, wind, tidal, small and medium hydro, biogas, no? Bagas. Or rather biomass, not biogas, biomass or bagas, for which we don't have to import the raw materials. Wala naman tayong endemic na stores ng yung mga nuclear minerals na kakailanganin for the generation of nuclear energy. Tapos kapag nagkaroon na tayo ng, we would have to import all those minerals. So mas mahal. And then pag nagkaroon na tayo ng radioactive wastes, eh magiging magnet pa yan sa mga kinakatakot na mga di umanong nuclear terrorists na who are trying to gather all such radioactive materials from different countries around the world for their development of nuclear weapons. Eh gusto na nga nating papalayo sa dati ng panganib ng nuclear conflict or even war. Why should the Philippines add to that deadly raw material?
All right. Now, of course, energy is a whole topic and it's a whole other show together. But let's move on. Just a few days back, you actually bared. Now, this was quite alarming. You bared fake job ads and the trafficking of Filipino workers to Myanmar. Let's talk about that. You spoke, is that correct, with 12 OFWs?
Yes, 12 OFWs, Karen, led by alias Rita, who were rescued by local and international NGOs based in Myanmar and Thailand, and with the help of our Department of Foreign Affairs on the Thailand side. And now here in the Philippines, our labor agencies, OWA, DMW. So Rita and her 11 companions had been recruited through Facebook online job ads, promised work as call center agents or data encoders in Thailand. Si Rita in particular, Karen, was contacted by a woman using the name Len, whose Facebook account, by the way, a few days ago was still active. Len instructed Rita at malamang yung labing isa pa how to get out of the country, how to smoothly get past immigration. Len and her colleagues provided Rita and her kasamas with all the proper travel documents. Pero pinagpanggap lang silang magtuturista sa Thailand. Mm-hmm. Aba, pagdating sa Thailand, they were taken on a bewildering 7 to 8 hour ride, no?
So they were kidnapped.
Actually, yun yung
Already
nangyari.
against their
They were
will.
kidnapped against their will because ang will nila was to take legitimate jobs in Thailand. Wow, they ended up in Myanmar in this place called Shwe Koko Economic Special Economic Zone, also known as Scam City. Scam City kasi kilala ito bilang safe haven for online gambling and fraud operators na usually mga miyembro ng Chinese mafia. And while there, they were forced to engage in a cryptocurrency scam, befriending and drawing into romantic relationships, targeted foreign clients who once nakuha na nila yung kumpiyansa ng mga taong ito, they would draw into cryptocurrency investment schemes.
Oo.
Pretending.
And fake. Na, fake
yes.
yung crypto scheme. Fake yun itself.
Fake mismo. Pati yung identity nila bilang mga mid or high level business or persons or entrepreneurs who became successful because of these cryptocurrency investments, they would draw in their intended victims into fake cryptocurrency financing schemes as well and eventually steal on behalf of their Chinese mafia syndicate employers, steal the money of these investors.
Okay. Now, Senator, would you have any idea how widespread is it? For example, how many Filipinos have fallen prey to this? How many Filipinos are working, I guess, in that particular town in Myanmar, acting as these crypto callers?
That's a good term.
Uh-oh.
Crypto callers. Yes, yung isang sama ng loob nga ni Rita, who was being groomed as a recruiter of other Filipino human trafficking and scamming victims. Sama ng loob niya, she learned that before her, there were two other Filipinos na inireklamo rin itong si Len.
Uh-oh.
And yet, umabot pa kay Rita at yung mga kabatch niya, kumbaga na mga yan, crypto callers, na nabiktima din sila. And even when they finally got safely home, ang sumbong ni Narita, there are at least 31 other Filipinos in their same former predicament. Traffic, forced to work as scammers, under terrible mental health pressure because of the pretense they have to engage in. At yung mga banta sa kanila, Karen, terrible threats. At yung iba sa kanila, including among the 31 na naiwan doon, alam ni Narita, sinasaktan. So we know only of those 31 others. Hindi pa natin alam. Yan ang pina-iimbestiga ko sa ating mga otoridad. And thanks to DMW, sabi nila, nag-iimbestiga na sila. We don't know how many other Filipinos are in this predicament. Sabi pa ni Narita, dahil nabisto nila itong Thailand to Myanmar corridor for trafficking victims turned crypto callers, naghahanap na ng connect daw yung kanilang Chinese syndicate bosses, former bosses, ng connect daw sa ating Bureau of Immigration at yung iba daw na mga biktima nila ng trafficking ay idinadaan na sa Malaysia. So this syndicate is trying to always keep one or several steps ahead of the game of our authorities. They are evolving like another virus in order to continue these operations.
Okay. And when you bear this in the Senate, is it right that they weren't actually given their salaries, even as crypto callers, they weren't treated properly? What exactly was the extent of the abuse?
Well, the abuse was, yes, until now, this batch who were able to be rescued, si Narita, may utang pa sa kanilang sweldo yung mga dating bosses nila. They were forced to work at least 12 or more hours a day. At kapag hindi sila makaproduce ng scamming victims,
parang
ng pera,
may quota sila,
Karen, ha? And if they couldn't deliver on their quota, lalo na among the 31 left behind, alam ni Narita, sinasaktan, and all of them who were not able to deliver on their quotas were subject to threats. Threatened to be made to do 1,000 push-ups, na magbuhat ng galong-galong tubig, to be hit by electric rods, and even to be stabbed until they died. Sabi ni Narita, pati silang mga babae, binabantaan na their corpses daw would just be left somewhere out in the open when they died. So really, really very, very abusive working conditions.
Okay. Now, I spoke with Secretary Toots Ople last week, and she thanks you for this exposé. But what can the government do? Let's talk about long-term planning. Number one, the problem is the recruitment is on Facebook. That's one.
Right.
Number two, you can go as a tourist to Thailand or Malaysia. So that's the other problem. But what about the Myanmar government, Senator? In terms of government-to-government agreements with this, what is the role of the Myanmar government?
That's a very good point, Karen. Tayo at yung Myanmar, pareho mga miyembro sa ASEAN. So already, and I did make a call to the DFA among other government agencies at muli salamat sa DFA sa tulong nila nung nakatawid na si Narita sa Thailand side ulit. Sinalubong sila ng ating DFA doon. DFA could open up this subject of discussion with their Myanmar counterparts, right? Speaking of Facebook. Thanks also to Facebook when they read the news and they saw our news outings and the social media posts about what happened to si Narita. They communicated with my office and asked for the information about Facebook pages. The pages Filipinos in Myanmar, and there's at least one other, Filipinos in Thailand rather, Filipinos in Thailand and Pogo secret files. And they said they would take action on this. Nanawagan din ako sa ibang mga platforms that Rita said had been used, WhatsApp, Telegram, even dating and even professional apps like LinkedIn. And then of course, our authorities, Bureau of Immigration, they need to really keep a lookout for these because dumadaan sa kanila eh, palabas at paloob. So they are also a line of defense for our our nationals.
Because what's difficult, Senator, in this situation is the laws are clear. They're anti-human trafficking laws. We all know it's illegal, right, Senator? And yet you have Filipinos, of course, wanting a better life, that they would do it outside the purview of the POEA. Yun yung malungkot.
Yes, and who doesn't want a better life, right? So in fact, hindi lang step one, pero step zero natin is to really provide more decent jobs dito sa Pilipinas, lalo na ngayong patapos ng pandemya where so many of our kababayan were hit with un- and underemployment. At nasa gitna pa tayo ng recession where kahit yung mga recent surveys show that it's really inflation, prices, and jobs, top of mind talaga na mga Pilipino. And then once lumabas tayo ng bansa, talagang kailangan siguruhin, lalong-lalo na ng ating gobyerno, na legit tayong lumalabas and ligtas tayo habang nasa ibang mga bansa. At kung we are abroad for work, that we are well represented and protected by our government, even while abroad.
Okay. And in the same breath, before we go to a quick break, the timing, considering that number one, the Department of Migrant Workers is a new department. And number two, magkano na po ang budget, ma'am, Senator ng DMW?
Okay, well, I can get back to you on how much we budgeted. First budget, kumbaga,
let me check that too. Yeah.
Binyag na budget ng DMW. Yes, it's a new department, and I really hope that over the next few years, hanggat umabot tayo sa sitwasyon na we have enough decent jobs here in the Philippines at pwedeng tignan yung sunset provision ng DMW law, that it will well and faithfully serve yung ating mga OFWs. Yeah. Tulad dito sa kasong ito, sinasek really have stepped up for Rita.
Okay, I checked my notes. The budget now, is, if this is correct, Senator, is it at 17 billion pesos, 4 billion going to the Office of the Secretary, 11.8 billion to the OWA? Because the budget, given the problems that Secretary Toots Ople will be facing, and this is one of them, does this actually help empower the DMW?
Well, it gets them off to a running start. Siyempre, sa susunod pang limang taon nitong administrasyon, ay DMW will have to get back to us in Congress how well did they spend the initial budget at sumapat ba ito at malamang sasabihin nila hindi, and how can we better support them in terms of next year's budget and so on. So okay. Magiging work in progress yan, Karen.
Senator Risa, let's talk about the budget. I know that, is that correct? It's now the BICAM. Naka-BICAM na po ba?
That's right. Nagba-BICAM na po, Karen.
Okay. And a big shift in the budget. Let's talk about this. It was quite controversial. But you actually moved to excise all of the DepEd confidential funds. Why did you do that? And why was it important for you to do that?
It was important, Karen, not actually to excise, but to transplant the DepEd confidential budget to the DepEd MOOE. Yung item nila, para sa mga programa nila. Because, for two reasons. Una, hindi naman mandate ng DepEd gumawa ng mga confidential or for that matter, intelligence operations, lalo na nasa gitna tayo ng education crisis. And DepEd itself also needs more funds para sa kanilang mga programa to address this crisis, to address learning poverty, to address the long-standing issues and needed reforms pagkatapos ng shift natin sa K-12. Lalo na't palabas pa lang tayo sa pandemic at nasa gitna pa tayo ng resesyon. And it was important to do that para maging mas accountable yung paggastos ng pondo nila. Ang confidential funds kasi, Karen, are not subject to regular audit by the Commission on Audit. So, importante para mapigilan din ang graft and corruption na mas kaunting confidential funds, lalo na sa mga civilian agencies na wala namang kinalaman sa intelligence work, for example. At importanteng i-shift yung I was able to move 120
Absolutely.
Million pesos.
Yeah.
Opo, 80% of the 150 million originally requested by DepEd for its confidential funds to its one of its MOOE programs on safe learning institutions.
Yeah.
At salamat muli kay Finance Committee Chair Angara at Minority Leader ko Pimentel at lahat ng mga kasama namin sa majority who supported this move.
I'd have to say the Senate really acted on this one, considering
yes,
the request
did.
Of DepEd for CONFI funds was at 150 million.
Yes.
It's now down to 30 million.
It is down to 20% of what they had requested. Na para sa akin, masyadong
The Senate took a stand.
We did take a stand, and additionally, sinuportahan din ng buong Senado yung iba pa naming mga amyenda ni Minority Leader Senator Coco. We got a general provision in that all agencies with confidential and intelligence funds should draw up a work plan for the use of these funds. At obligado rin silang at the tail end to submit quarterly reports to both houses of Congress kung paano nila ginastos ang mga confidential at intelligence funds na ito.
Okay. Now, I wanted to ask you, noticeably, I mean, we've seen the confidential funds of the Office of the President grow through the years.
Yes.
I remember it started at 500 million pesos. Do you remember that, Senator? And through
yes,
the years, right, it
yes,
just
yes.
started to grow, and it's now, am I correct, at 5 billion. Is it at 5 billion, the Office of the President, or less?
I think you're right. Something like that.
Yeah. So
I can get back to you on that again. Yes.
And noticeably, more and more government agencies were appealing for confidential funds. So the Senate actually realigned, right? The confidential funds agencies were requesting, yeah, DFA, DOJ, DSWD, executive offices, the ombudsman. But what does this mean exactly to the culture of actually wanting confidential funds in your budget?
Exactly.
Parang nawiwili. Nawiwili, Senator.
Actually, that's a really important observation, Karen. Kasi kahit tignan mo yung mga budget ng ibang mga bansa o ibang mga gobyerno sa mundo, not everybody has confidential and intelligence funds, or not everybody has CIFs to this magnitude or at least proportion of their budgets. At kahit tignan natin siguro yung budget history natin dito sa Pilipinas, apparently this practice of having confidential and intelligence funds kahit sa mga civilian agencies ha, would date back to a particular presidential decree. I forget the exact number now. So isa rin itong legacy yan ng batas militar ng diktadura. And it is something now embedded, if I'm not mistaken, in our administrative code. So, interesante at palagay ko importanteng pag-aralan natin or at namin no, sa Senado o sa Kongreso, are there also budget reforms we can introduce?
Yes.
By way of course, legislation, yung amendments sa administrative code man yun or sa iba pa. Para it's kahit sa households natin, di ba? Wala naman tayong confidential funds in household budget.
What makes this, what alarmed me when I was reading it is, why is it that these civilian agencies think that they can now ask for confidential funds?
Yun na nga. Yun yung bahagi nung sinabi mong nawili na yata kami sa gobyerno. And maybe it's not a healthy habit that we've developed over the decades. And maybe it's healthier sana yung nagawa naming pag-realign ng 120M from DepEd Confi to DepEd programs, no, safe learning institutions, baka it's a step in the right direction to surface more of the government funds. After all, ang government funds ay taxpayers' funds. To surface more of them in the annual budget para subject sa regular COA auditing, subject din sa regular citizen examination to make more honest brokers of us in government over time. Na dahil alam naming i-audit yung budget na ibinigay sa amin ng taxpayers mamamayan at ng Kongreso, na we will be more transparent and accountable. At maikikwenta namin yon every year sa COA maipagmamalaki namin at hindi ikahihiya. Of course, ibang usapin yung intelligence funds ng mga ahensya natin and I say the professionals na talagang may kinalaman. For example, sa National Defense or yung Armed Forces or yung National Police. But even they, dito sa Pilipinas and I think lalo na sa ibang mga bansa, have long-standing practices kung paano or at least paano dapat maging accountable para sa pot yon.
Now, very quickly, speaking of accountability, Congressman Paul Daza actually, he also exposed a particular issue of the DICT downloading budget that was allotted for broadband, downloaded to other agencies for them to help the DICT. So I think 1 billion was downloaded to the MMDA, a few other hundred millions to other agencies, and it's supposed to help the DICT with its broadband. Is that allowed by law in terms of disbursing the budget?
Well, that's I thank Rep. Daza for pointing that out. So ngayon, with Congress's oversight function, dahil sa amin yung power of the purse, proper na i-follow up namin yung observation niya by asking, were these monies downloaded by DICT within its budgeted for programs within its online item budget? May line ba sila na to download to other
MMDA
agencies for their ICT programs?
But can that be done? I mean, because of course we're all familiar with the Supreme Court decision on the DAP, right?
Yes,
but then does this fall under that, Senator? Because that was part of our discussion. Can you actually download to another agency, which is what the DOH did to the it's a very similar.
Yes.
Yung pinasa mo yung trabaho to another agency.
Correct.
Pwede ba yun?
Correct. Well, of course, at para sa akin, so thank you for reminding me of that, Karen. Para sa akin, live issue pa rin yung formally, even in connection with the human trafficking we were talking about earlier. But yung ginawa ng formally o ng DOH sa PSDBM, that has really come under strong and justified fire. And we have a lot of not just reforms to do there, but I think justice to be done still. Ito namang DICT to other agencies, In principle, maja-justify lamang siya if DICT has a line item in its department budget appropriated by Congress na spend for the ICT programs of other agencies na humingi ng tulong ng DICT or partnership
okay.
ng DICT.
Now, so, I'm sorry to interrupt. Before we go, because I know you have to step out at 8:40, because you have, I think you have a commission on appointments, hearing.
CA has a fantastic event on against violence against women and children. So, papunta ako.
You mean the Court of Appeals?
Or no, the Commission on Appointments.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. Now, very quickly, all the senators agree that health workers deserve a pay increase. Pero ang tanong, saan ito, Senator, is it even possible? Because I think in the deliberations, you have, they want, I think, 33,000, a minimum monthly pay of 33,000. Tama ba ito, ma'am?
Yes.
Saan kukunin ang pondo po?
Yun yung magiging trabaho ng Kongreso pa rin, kapartner sa DOH, because that was passed into law. So entitlement nila sa ilalim ng batas. So pero sa gitna nitong masikip na fiscal space, kailangan magkutkut kami sa budget. Nasaan posibleng merong undisbursed funds ng DOH, saan sila may savings in terms of compensation for healthcare workers, lalo na nung mga unang taon ng pandemya. So what is owed is due, and trabaho ngayon ng DOH ibayad yon sa mga healthcare workers sa public sector, at sana mag-oversight din sila sa kalagayan ng ating mga healthcare workers sa private sector at sa ating mga LGUs, at continuing obligation din ng Kongreso. Hanapan nyo ng pondo, because we're not just talking of year 2022, may mga utang pa sa kanila from 2021 at least.
All right. Senator Risa Ontiveros, it's been very insightful speaking to you this morning. Thank you for joining me, ma'am. I know you have a busy day
Salamat.
Today. So thank you for joining us on Head Start. You take care.
Salamat. Ingat din, Karen.